Have you ever wondered what our ancestors did before they had potato and rice? Well, they had to come out into the countryside and forage for food. And we're going to do that today. Let's go and see what we can find.
No meal's totally for free, and we're hunting chicken. Sometimes you've got to use a bit of cunning.
But this chicken lives up a tree. It's not easy to get. Chicken of the woods. This is one of the best edible fungi. There we go. Brilliant. Chicken of the woods. This fungus gets its name because it has the texture of chicken flesh. You pull it apart, it's stringy. It's really good eating, and it's quite easy to identify because it likes to grow on wood, and it looks like yellow polystyrene pouring out of the tree. But as always with wild fungi, if you're not certain of what you've got, don't eat it, because some of them are very poisonous. But there are some other things around here which are a bit safer to eat. Wow, this is a good one. This is burdock. This is like a bush potato, really. But it's going to take quite a bit of digging up, so I'll just get on with it. Nice sandy soil here. It makes life a bit easier. The root tends to go a long way down, but it's well worth digging. Plenty of small ones, sometimes these are very big. But there is our root, and it's got a thick rind on it, which we'll take off first. I can peel that off. There's the root inside. Okay, and this can be boiled in pieces like potato. You've changed the water several times because it's muddy tasting. Or better still, I like to fry it, stir fry it, perhaps with some black pepper, and use it as an hors d'oeuvre. Delicious. Brilliant. Burdock. You can eat it raw too. Could be a bit chewy. Well, we've seen some of the common British plants, but at this time of year, there's something even better, and we've saved the best for last. This is one of the crown jewels of the British countryside. Come and have a look. The pignut. Now, this may take a few minutes. I have to follow it very carefully down to an edible root. Funny thing is, on the way here today, we met a lady who could remember gathering these when she was a little girl in Yorkshire. It's amazing how knowledge that was once common can so quickly disappear. There he is. What a monster. God, it couldn't be better. Look at that. Isn't that magic? Just listen to that crunch. Sort of a cross between a sweet chestnut and a radish. Do you want to try some, Chris?
Yeah, sure, thanks.
You know, it's good to come out and enjoy the countryside, and even better if you can taste some of the wild food. But use your common sense. We must be careful not to destroy the things we love.
Is where the Atlantic Ocean meets the north coast of Cornwall, and out there, the next stop is America.
These huge waves on Fistral Beach have probably travelled hundreds of miles.
As you can see, there's loads of surf out there.
It's pretty wild.
Is it just the wind that is creating the waves?
Well, quite simply, in a nutshell, yeah, it is the wind that actually produces the surf that we see breaking here on the beach.
Barry's expertise goes a little further than theory. He's British team coach and has been surfing for 20 years. Looking at that lot, I'm going to need more than a day's coaching.
And this is just very early stuff.
After the basics of board control, it was time to take the plunge. To get you going, Barry helps you onto the waves to develop balance and positioning.
One, two, three. Whew. One, two, three. free. Hold your balance. You ready? Look forward.
To have full control of the board and really enjoy the thrill, you need to learn to pop up. Easier said than done. The only problem is I'm always just getting going when I run out of wave. Watching these surfers in Newquay, it's easy to become addicted, or in my case, frustrated because I'm not good enough to head further out to sea. So when Barry suggested a trip inland to surf a wave that runs for miles, well, it just had to be done.
Okay, guys, all the way from Newquay to Gloucester and not a wave in sight. It's flat calm out there. Has Barry put you up to this?
No, but this is something special. This is the Seven Ball and this is a tidal wave.
I don't even like the sound of tidal wave, to be honest. Okay, you've got the current going down, so it comes up the way?
Yeah, I'll show you. This is the River Severn.
Yeah.
Now, what happens with the River Severn, the water moves up from out in the estuary with the tide. As it comes in, everything narrows down, not going into a funnel. So what's going to happen is, as the water comes into a lower water, into shallower depth, okay, the water moves up and it forms a wave, and the wave just peels up, breaks over.
So just like on the shore at Newquay then,
same principle? Yeah, same principle, but it's on a river, it's fresh water, and it only happens about 4 or 5 times a month.
Oh my God!
There it is.
The Severn Bore runs for 23 miles upstream and can be 8 feet high. Tom's mate Dave was happy to demonstrate.
Yeah.
Look at it tearing up that bank.
Yeah, don't move down too far, Dave. Go on, Dave.
Oh my!
He's got it. Yes.
Unlike surfing at sea, the technique is to stay on the shoulder rather than the face of the wave. It doesn't hang about either. At 16 miles an hour, it dredges up the river, sweeping everything in its path, including kayakers who are out for a free ride. Meanwhile, upstream, the countdown had begun. The bore can be 20 minutes either side of the expected arrival time, so we got ready with plenty to spare. Once you're in the freezing water, the biggest problem is keeping your position as the current tries to take you back downriver. The sense of anticipation as you hang out, ready to catch the wave, is incredible. A mix of sheer terror for me and excitement. When I saw it, I was petrified, but with Matt egging me on, I really needed to get paddling. By the way, I had no intention of even attempting to stand up.
That was the best thing ever! Absolutely fantastic! The thrill